Welcome to the session on compassionate communities and palliative care. Thank you very much for coming out to join us on this Friday night of the Orkney Science Festival. We're very excited to be here, and I'm very excited to have my associates from the University of Glasgow up in my adopted hometown. My name is Kate Jackson. I work as a journalist, and I have a specific focus on hospice and palliative care worldwide. My colleagues here, some of you from the session before will remember Reverend Hamilton Inbadas, who is part of the End of Life Studies group at the University of Glasgow, and also his colleague, Dr. Shahaduz Zaman. The End of Life Studies group is funded by the Wellcome Trust to undertake a research project looking at global interventions at the end of life. So looking at how communities across the world have responded to the challenges that are associated with our aging population and with the increasingly complex conditions that we face as we age in the 21st century. So the way that the session will be structured is Zaman will give a presentation about compassionate communities, and then we'll have a little panel discussion for 15 minutes. And then if I could just ask everyone, if you have a question, just to hold on to it until the end, because then we'll have a general, we'll open the questions up to the audience and we can have a discussion amongst ourselves. So I'd just like to invite Zaman up to the podium. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kate, and thank you all for joining. As Kate said, my name is Shahaduz Zaman. I come from very far, far from here. I come from Bangladesh, but I work with the Glasgow University End of Life Studies Group. And as Kate was just saying, at this university, we are trying to have an understanding of the different kinds of interventions at the end of life care globally, internationally, so in different countries. And we are actually having a social science examination of different kinds of interventions. So that's how we came here in the science festival, as a social scientist, not as like science in the core sense. I am medically qualified, but I moved to anthropology. Medical anthropology is my area of work, but in my earlier career, I also worked as a doctor. So as part of this project, I'm conducting different case studies on different kinds of intervention. And one of these case studies is compassionate community. And trying to understand, again, from social science perspective, what is it all about and what are the challenges. The whole idea of compassionate community developed from the critique to the conventional way of handling end-of-life care, the palliative care, the conventional way of palliative care. As we all know, generally, the dying person is sent to the hospital or hospices, and that's how the end-of-life care and treated by a specialist, palliative care specialist, that's how conventionally death and dying is handled. But the advocates of compassionate community suggest that this is probably not the best way to and the ideal way to handle death, particularly if we see from a global perspective. Is this the most medically sound, culturally appropriate, and economically viable way of dealing with death and dying? Probably not. So what they are suggesting is de-institutionalize death, de-medicalize death. So currently, death and dying is being handled by institutions. So by making by talking about deinstitutionalized, they are talking about making death everyone's business. So what they're suggesting is that the death should be responsibility of the community of that person. So One of the pioneers of this this idea is Professor Ellen Kelleher and his book on compassionate cities, where he advocates these ideas. And there are other scholars and also practitioners who are advocating this idea of compassionate community. So what they're suggesting is that you know, the one of the pioneers of palliative care, Cicely Saunders, talked about total pain. And she talked about there are four dimensions of this total pain: physical pain, social pain, psychological pain, and spiritual pain. And the advocates of the compassionate community suggest that most of these pains can be handled by general people, by lay people, with a little bit of training and skill. It's only for a certain aspect of physical pain that demands specialist attention. So it is possible if we could make death a responsibility of the community, solve a lot of the problems and obstacles that we are facing in institutional end-of-life care. And they would like to focus on the social capital of the community. So by social capital, they mean compassion of the people, common sense of the people. So compassion as the tool to provide help. So people, with the motivation of compassion, will people take responsibility of the members of the community. So Kelleher was inspired by the idea of healthy cities that was advocated by WH, World Health Organization, where they talked about a eco-friendly, holistic health policies for countries and cities. But what he was suggesting that a healthy person without compassion can be dangerous. So it can be dangerous to others. So it's not about being healthy, but it's important to be compassionate. We should think of making a society that is compassionate, not just healthy. He has proposed number of, the practitioners or the advocates of compassionate community proposed different steps to interventions to make society compassionate, changes in the policy, also changing the curriculum, a medical curriculum, incorporating compassion in different fields of the study, training people, raising awareness about compassionate, and so on. But there are a lot of challenges, particularly what the different studies and observations says that to practice compassion, and in general, in the palliative care situation, but also in the community, they're particularly talking about the developed, industrialized, high-income countries, compassion is missing to a great extent. They're suggesting different ways to bring back that compassion. But interestingly, there are examples, some good examples in other parts of the world, and some in some developing countries. When I'm talking about developed and developing countries, I'm just using it in a general term, developed country, referring to high-income European and North American Western countries, and developing countries, low-income countries from the South. So one of the successful example of community-based palliative care is in India. Two doctors, Dr. Suresh Kumar and Dr. Raja Gopal, they are quite known in the palliative care field. They are also a big advocates for community-based palliative care. And they work in Kerala, one of the states of Kerala, and they've very successfully implemented the community-based palliative care, where the community takes responsibility of the dying patient. So the and this particular Kerala model has been acknowledged as the demonstration project for World Health Organization. So this is considered as one of the successful project in the community-based palliative care. So what they do is they invite the people in the community to give some time, specifically 2 hours in a day, in a week, to dedicate to some of the terminal patients in their community, in their village. And those who volunteer, they give them training. Some specialists give them training on some basics of palliative care and all those, these four aspects of total pain. And then they rotate and take responsibility of the dying patient of the community, and the patients are treated in their home. And they also generate fund from the community, so it don't depend on external funding. And just to give you an statistics of the success of this model, India has 28 states. Except this state, Kerala, most of the states have palliative care units. So in the rest of the states, the number of unit ranges from 1 to 16, whereas in Kerala, there are more than 300 units. So the extent is huge. So what is there that's making it a success? And so I'm just in the middle of doing this study, case studies, trying to understand. So I've been to Kerala recently. I just wanted to give a small example from my field work that I did in Kerala. I wanted to follow a particular volunteer and wanted to see how they work. So I was introduced to a volunteer, a female volunteer, whose name is Maluti. So for the first time I went to Kerala. I've never been to Kerala. Again, as I said, I'm from Bangladesh, not from India. So she took me to the. So I wanted to go with her to the house where the patient patient lies. So on her way on our way. She was talking all about her life, how she got involved in this palliative care, volunteerism, about her husband, about her two children. So she said she was a volunteer in a political party, local political party. And then she became a volunteer in the palliative care project when this project has started. So she was telling me that when I was a political activist, I always had some enemies. There are some enemies that didn't like me. And I always had to follow someone's decision. But this is the first time in my life when I entered into this palliative care volunteerism, I don't have any enemies. And I follow only my heart. So she was very happy the way she is working. She also asked me everything about me, my family, my children, my wife. My mother lives in Bangladesh, so she was very concerned how my father feels, my mother feels back home. Do I miss her? And all sorts of personal discussion. So on my way, she said, before the village of that patient, I need to go to a particular household where I know there's a sick boy. So I just wanted to check the boy and go there and just 10, 15 minutes. So we stopped. I said, do they know? She said, no, that's not important. I'll just go and check how he's doing. So we stopped by the road. She went. Had spent some time there. She came back. Then we went to that particular house. I saw how, she spent a good quality time for half an hour, 40 minutes with that patient. She took care of the bed sores, then gave some training to the wife of the patient about the exercises the patient needs to do. This was a man in his 60s with prostate cancer, bedridden for many months. And he was also. She was also making. She was telling me the story of this life story of this person, that this person is a Christian by religion, got married to a Hindu girl, and she was telling me all sorts of trouble she went through when they were trying to get married. They were making jokes about it, and she made the whole atmosphere quite humorous and light. So then she finished her home visit there, and we came out of the house, and there was a time for lunch. So I said, let's go to have a lunch in a nearby restaurant. She said, no, we're not going to a restaurant. I have already called one of my fellow volunteer in the neighboring village to prepare lunch for us, and we'll go and have lunch there. So we both went there and had lunch with all sorts of delicious Indian food. And then we came back to the office where the palliative care center. Again, on the way, we talked all sorts of things, and she was curious of a lot of things about myself, about UK, and telling me all about her village. And when it was time to say goodbye, and she said, "Give me 5 minutes. I brought something from my home. I dry banana." So there's a packet of banana I brought for you. I know that you are coming. So it is kept in a building, nearby building, so I'll bring it. So she brought the bag of banana and gave it to me. And then it was time to say goodbye, and I said, okay, goodbye. And I was closing the car window. We took a car. And she said, "When are you coming again?" I said, "Yeah, I'm not sure whether I'm coming again, but most likely I'll be coming again." And I could see tears in her eyes. And then we said goodbye, and I returned. What I'm trying to say, I mean, what I saw in this just one day spending with her, a sense of community, a sense of connectedness. Also a compassion, and also a sense of reaching for others in her. We can debate whether it's compassion or not, but in general, there's a sense of togetherness, there's a sense of connectivity, there's a sense of belongingness, and sense of relational self. So that's what I experience. And probably that's what is the essence of compassionate community. But I must say that I'm not suggesting that everyone in Kerala is like Maluti with all this passion and connectedness. And I'm not suggesting that India or developing country is full of this compassion and free-flowing compassion. But what I feel is that there are some structural advantages that helps certain practice, certain behavior to put it into practice, which is very difficult in an industrialized, quote unquote, developed countries. So that's what I'm. I have lived experience from Global South and Global North, and also from social science study. I see some of the barriers in these developed countries for this kind of connectedness, togetherness, and free-flowing compassion. So just briefly, I would like to list some of the barriers that I think. So it's not just about giving training, not about including compassion in the curriculum, but there are deep-rooted structural issues, structural problems, and the way we have developed the society creates some barrier to practice a certain kind of compassionate community. For example, the whole sense of privacy and independence in the Western world. There's the pivotal role of privacy and the sense of independence. And at the end of life, that's one thing people have to sacrifice, is independence. But there is a extreme sense of independence in most of the industrialized countries. So such a situation where privacy and independence is so important, and individual self is so important rather than relational self, it becomes very difficult to practice compassion as a community. There's also a cultural aspect of the notion of death. Lots of social science literature also talks about this Western society being death-denying society. So as if death doesn't exist. So it's a society that only celebrates youth. There are anthropological work that suggests that putting dying person in a hospital is also a way to take death away from the social scene. And there are many people who haven't experienced death or haven't seen death. So death is something is not in the public narrative. That also becomes very difficult to develop a compassionate community around end-of-life care. There are also institutional barriers. The whole palliative care and end-of-life care is institutionalized, that I just mentioned, and professionalized. So when everything is professionalized, there's little scope for lay person to participate in this whole palliative care business. So there is no gap. It's highly professional and highly institutionalized. So it's very difficult for social capital to get engaged in this whole institutional way of dealing with this. There are also legal barriers. The public behavior of most of the Western society is guided by law, people are anxious about litigation, and this whole obsession about health and safety. That's also a barrier for building a compassionate community. I remember when I first came to UK about 7-6 years back. So I was facing the first winter, and I was staying in Newcastle, and it's heavy snow. And I received a leaflet from the city council about how to prepare for the snow. And there was one clause there there's no law to prevent you to help your neighbor who is elderly to clean his pavement if he cannot do that. It really took a lot of time for me to understand this fact that I need to think about law before helping an elderly person. So this health and safety obsession and all this whole sense of litigation makes it very difficult to build a compassionate community. There's also this society has become a risk society and a society of suspicion. People suspect each other. I go to any big rail station or airport or even a small rail station, there's always this announcement or notice that if you see any suspicious behavior, report it to the police. So there's a suspicion in the air. And it's very difficult to build a compassionate society when there is suspicion all around. So that's another, this the political dimension, political reality of the contemporary world. There are also economic barriers. We live in a free market economy, and free market economy always prioritizes individual interest rather than collective interest. And compassion for others can be actually, I mean, it's not beneficial for free market. It can be counterproductive. In order to success in a free economy, I have to be individual, and I need to put my individual interest first. So if that's the case, and if we want to be successful and productive in a free market economy, compassion doesn't help much. And that's how we gradually, everything has become individualized. People's leisure time has been individualized, privatized. People don't spend leisure time together. And that's also part of this this whole promotion of individualism. So all this, and there are, I mean, I have a few more. I mean, how this instability of residence in this contemporary world also plays a role, or plays against the against building a compassionate community. So we are constantly changing our residences. So that's a barrier to develop a compassion within a particular community. So what I'm suggesting is that compassionate community is an interesting idea, but it's not just about training people about compassion, or just including compassion in the curriculum. There are deep-rooted structural problems. These are big questions and big problem. And the paradox is, I'm talking about, I just mentioned, gave an example from the developing world. The paradox is, probably there are still some opportunities to practice in the developing world because they're not so-called modern yet. They're in a pre-modern state. The institutions are weak. So still family is the main institution, community is the institution. This probably facilitates. But the problem is the whole world is trying to adapt the model of the developed world. So the developing world wants to be like developed world. And most of the time, the models and the ideas developed in the developed world is transferred to the developing world. Without having much of the critical view to these models, with the assumption that the developing world should catch up with the developed world at some point. So one of the subaltern thinker, Chakraborty, he talks about waiting room of history. So the idea of, again, it's in terms of modernity. So the modernity has appeared in the Western Europe first, and it should be transferred to other parts of the world. And the other parts of the world is in an imaginary waiting room to graduate to this this modernity. And they need to go through certain process and to graduate to become a real modern. So there's a thrust to become modern, like many of the European countries. But unfortunately, even within UK, recently there has been the Economist published the world ranking of quality of death, and UK has topped the list. But unfortunately, there are lots of debate within the system, palliative care system in UK, and it has, I mean, you probably know that this, the Liverpool care pathway, one highly celebrated, has been abandoned. But there are a lot of other issues, other debates. So that debate doesn't transfer. It's only some ideas. So what I'm talking is this paradox of the problem with this structure that we have developed, But unfortunately, we are also promoting that the whole the global world should, or the palliative care, if we bring back to this discussion on end-of-life care or palliative care, so there should be a common future for palliative care. What I'm suggesting is that probably there should not be a common future. There are there should be multiple future. And this is a challenge for both developed and developing world. Yesterday we were in the island Sapinsi, and I could hear from them that they still have this is a small society, and they have this sense of community and bit of connectedness and togetherness, but they're really struggling to keep that because there's pressure of to be real modern. They're not yet modern. So they also need to be modern, like many European typical societies. So it's a challenge for both these societies. How do we handle? We keep some of the features of modernity, but also we keep some of the basic essence of being human and keep our compassion intact. So that's a challenge for both developing countries and developed countries. And in our research, what we are trying to suggest and recommend people to think that probably we should not think for a common standard way of solution, rather than look for a multiple solution based on the local realities and local context. So I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Zaman, for that very interesting presentation. So now, I understand that the two of you were having a chat about defining compassion earlier today, and I was wondering if you'd like to share some of those thoughts with us. Maybe Hamilton, if you want to start.
Yes, can you hear me well?
Well, you asked
me.
Yeah, go on.
There are two fundamental issues here which strike me when I look at the phrase compassionate community. Number one, doesn't it presume the existence of a community already? Now, if you look at community in the world we live in, there is a geographical issue here. Communities are no longer local as they used to be. I mean, there are all sorts of online communities. So the way we understand community is defined not geographically these days. It's more kind of a peer group orientation to it. How much of the current understanding of community or the current reality of community of non geographically oriented nature come in relevance to the notion of compassionate community, where you actually have to be physically there to help and to support those who are in need. So that's the second word, community. The first is the whole notion of compassion, and it's how do we take that word and use it for a community? Is it something that automatically expresses by volunteers in palliative care, trained, going out and doing things? Is compassion not a lot more than that, where somebody is voluntarily, willingly seeing the need of another person, takes on the responsibility or the additional responsibility, going out of the way to do some things which is actually not my own responsibility. Because when we talk about this volunteers as part of the community, as part of delivering compassion becomes sort of my responsibility. It is my responsibility to be compassionate to somebody. Does my question is, does compassion not come from somewhere deep within me? at the site of a need spontaneously outside my call of responsibility. So those are the questions that I was trying to raise.
I mean, of course, these are both, I mean, if we go into definitional debate, there's always a problem. But the point I was trying to make is a bit different. Of course, there are different kinds of community nowadays. It doesn't have to be a geographical community. But what I'm trying to say is the compassion doesn't depend on the type of the community. You don't have to be geographically present to be compassionate, geographically proximate to each other to be compassionate. So it can be a virtual community, but whether they have the compassion. And what you said is, of course, compassion, the way compassion is defined is, some people define that compassion ask us to go where there's pain. So it's particularly care for others, particularly for the vulnerable people. So of course it should come within, but what I was trying to say that there are structural barriers in certain societies to bring that out, even if you have compassion. So for example, the instance I was giving about Maloti. So if I take her, whatever you would like to call it, compassion, or so what I saw is an urge to reach to others. So if I take that spirit and bring it here and the city I live as a thing and allow it to flow, okay, let's see whether this spirit can flow. Exactly for those reasons what I said, I mean, just because of this, because of people's sense of privacy, because of this litigation issues, because of this economic issues, it would be very difficult for that free flowing spirit to be active. So that was my point.
Okay. I had another question that kind of came up from yesterday's discussion and also from today's discussion. We've spoken a lot about the structural barriers in society that prevent free-flowing compassion from working. The reality is that the barriers aren't going to disappear overnight. So I was wondering if there were any kind of, you know, small ways or small practical advice that you could give to people to start to build a compassionate community kind of within the system without us all burning things and being radical. I was just wondering if you had advice on the little things that we can do to be more compassionate.
Yeah, I mean, of course, the point that I raised are big questions, and it's structural questions, and it's never going to be addressed overnight. It demands lots of actions, thinking. But one thing is to raise these questions first, and then it's not just for one individual or certain social scientists to come up with ideas. But if we all acknowledge that this is a problem, and we should think together. But of course, until that happens, there are a lot of ways we definitely can try to find bring out people's compassion and utilize this compassion. I remember I had a discussion with Dr. Suresh Kumar, who is the pioneer of Kerala model, is quite renowned in the palliative care world. So I was asking him this as well. I mean, what do you think? I mean, how can we... So he also did an experiment in Switzerland, in one of these small community in Switzerland. So he was jokingly telling me that it's interesting. He said, in a system that doesn't allow lay people to act is an underdeveloped system. He said, I call most of the European system underdeveloped because it doesn't allow lay people to participate. Mm-hmm. And for that, we need to create a gap, even if it is so tight as a system, we need to create a gap for the lay general people to participate. Mm-hmm. And that's what he tried in Switzerland. I don't have the detail of that, but there's some interesting experience there. And he tried to create a gap within the system so that all the social capital that we are talking, people have common sense, people have compassion, people have intent to care for others, but just because of the closed system, they cannot function. So they did something there, and so probably we should explore more.
Yeah. I think systems and structures are there for a reason, and they were certain things in life are systematized so that it can benefit people. That's the ultimate goal. But in doing so, it loses some other aspects of life which might be critical. I think, you know, your question was, you know, are there simple ways in which we as ordinary people engage in promoting compassion? Well, what I'm going to say now won't probably apply to Orkney and other similar communities. Alan Kelleher and his colleagues were trying to say, you know, if you're taking your dog out for a walk, you are obviously with some other people whom you come across either on from the opposite direction or somebody who's walking in the same direction.
You don't have to start. You don't think that you're wrong.
All right.
You've told us not to intervene, but I think it has to be.
Yes, I mean, our society has become one such where you can be the only person on the road. You're absolutely right. In a situation where you happen to see another person, this is what Alan and colleagues were suggesting, don't ignore the other person. See them, look at them, and be sensitive and engage with them. But the problem is, the word sensitive, we are often a bit too sensitive. We do not want to engage because we are afraid that we will be stepping on somebody's toe. I mean, the snow story was very interesting. Many years ago, when I first came into Europe, it was Belgium. I was traveling in a bus. I was sitting there, and the bus was filling up. There was this very elderly lady standing next to me, and I, as custom in my place, and how I grew up, I just jumped up and asked her to sit down. She gave me a look. Well, obviously, I didn't understand it at that point. I had to take it to a colleague of mine and explain it to her. What did I do wrong there? And then you all know the answer. It's that being sensitive has a totally different connotation there. So, but again, because we know each other's sensitivity in local communities where we live, there might be areas where we can still know, okay, this will be an opportunity to engage with the person. What that gets us is an opportunity for the community to engage with one another, the individuals of a community to engage with one another a bit more than perhaps what it is now. These are not rocket science things. I mean, we all know these exist in some form or the other. It's giving it much more visibility and practically realizing it. Forming such community could, according to the theory, lead to increased support at the end of life.
Mm-hmm.
Again, it's a theory. I'm sorry, I didn't get that question.
Shall we take this opportunity to open it up to the floor? Do we have the roving mic still? Thank you very much to our panelists while we get the mic.
Can we take this opportunity to actually open up to the floor to get their understanding of what palliative care actually is and what it means to them and how they understand it? Since I thought that's what this chat tonight was about.
Who do you refer to as they here?
Sorry?
Who are the they?
The specialists.
The general public.
Oh.
Sure. Would someone like to share their understanding of palliative care?
Robin, do you want to?
In answer to your question, I think our speakers have highlighted the very trap that we've fallen into, which is that we've over-specialised the nature of caring for people at the end of life. We had labelled it palliative care. Now, in technical terms, palliative care could be narrowed down to saying to palliate is to relieve suffering and pain and anxiety, particularly in the context of an end-of-life experience. I was just responding to you saying how ought it to be defined, but I think by defining it in narrow terms, we've then reduced it to, I'm coming from a medical background, to reducing it to being an issue of therapeutics. And therefore, in medical training, a lot of the emphasis would be on how to manage pain, how to manage nausea, how to manage dyspnea. Now, going back to the issue of having a compassionate and common sense based approach to the needs of people who are at the end of life, we need to broaden it. And professionalising palliative care has been, Cicely Saunders was a hero in her time, but she's actually given birth to something which is now serving us badly, because it has narrowed it down. And dare I say, even in the Kerala model, if you say we have to have training, I tell you, in the UK, the desire for law and order, will everybody queues in the UK? You understand that coming from the other countries like Bangladesh. Nobody queues in Bangladesh, as far as I know. But but everybody would queue up to have a certificate in how to do 2 hours a week as a palliative care support worker. And so even there, there's a barrier that we almost automatically key into. So how is palliative care expanded? By actually dismantling the professionalism that has made it so good. That's a paradox, but I think it's, in my opinion, one of the ways forward.
Yeah. Thanks very much, Robin. I think what the End of Life Studies Group is trying to do is trying to address an issue that we're going to run up against, and that the people who are trained as specialist palliative care physicians and palliative care nurses are not going to be enough people to meet the need of the aging population with complex end-of-life issues. So it's very important to explore different ways to provide end-of-life care. And that's why I think that it's so important to have academics questioning, and, you know, they don't have the answers. They are asking the questions and trying to find different ways to address this problem, which will be a very large problem in the future, I think.
I'm very attracted to the idea of lay people participating in palliative care, but one of the things I do know from personal experience is that pain relief is absolutely central to easing somebody's passing. And from my experience, it's a very medicalized business and a very specialized business. Do you see any way of a layperson being able to take over the very complex and very medicalized business of pain relief? Because I mean, I know you talked about other sorts of pain, but physical pain, from what I know about the subject, is absolutely key. Can a lay person possibly be trained in such an expert and technical business?
Mm-hmm. No, that's a...
Can I just quickly, then you can come back. Of course, I mean, this pain relief is the key in palliative care. And availability of morphine, and these are the key issues in global scenario. And of course, these are bigger questions, and that needs to be addressed. Again, as she said, we always don't have answers, but I can take the discussion to another level. I mean, I know societies where, I mean, in this society, when we talk about good death, one of the main criteria is a pain-free death. So in many societies, good death is not a pain-free death. It doesn't have to be completely pain-free. Pain can be, I mean, I was working with a group in Himachal, the Buddhist community. So they have a different way of dealing with the pain. They don't need
a med... Is everyone here talking about this society and death here?
Yeah, so we are talking about the value of good death. So can we think of changing the value? But this is again said, this is a completely different level of discussion. This may not be applied to many societies. But the point is, that's not the only one. When we talk about good death, is there one single definition of good death? In this society, good death has the element of pain-freeness, autonomy, privacy, independence. These are part of good death. But in many societies, these are not the elements of good death. So what I consider, good death has two components. One is value, one is logistic. So if you want to ensure the value is privacy, pain-free death, independence, then you have a certain logistic, you need a certain logistic supply. You need morphine, you need hospital. But if you have a different value of good death, you'd need a different kinds of logistic. If someone says that the best way I can die is surrounded by my children, that's the only thing I want at the end of my life. So that the logistic would be different. I can give you an, I'm not saying which, I mean, this is a bad way of dying, this is a good way of dying. I'm not judging. But there are various ways of dying. Just talking from my own personal experience, I attended the terminal days of my father. And of course, we don't have that much of institutional facilities, so we had to keep my father in home, and definitely with lots of limitations. So there are times when I provided care to my father, and I had to do something that I never did. So I had to clean my father, taking off his clothes, and it was quite embarrassing for me. So I was asking at one point to my father, do you feel embarrassed that I'm doing this, or do you have any concern? But my father said, no, I think I'm giving you the opportunity to do this for me. So there's a different way of taking this. He has no concern of completely surrendering his independence. And he considers it is an opportunity for me, that I have an opportunity to take care of her in him in the last days. So what I'm trying to say is there are different ways of defining good death. We should not try to define good death in a certain way and try to develop the logistic in that specific way. Please.
So from that level, let me bring it down to practical ways of answering your question. I mean, particularly taking the Kerala model, volunteers are trained to acknowledge and recognize pain when it is there. So, but they very closely work with doctors and nurses. So what happens is when they know that a patient needs attention to pain, they immediately get the doctors and nurses to come and see them at their homes, or refer them to the clinic if the patient is able to go. So the point is, of the four dimensions that was referred to, the physical, psychological, social, and spiritual, the palliative care world has this famous imagery of the iceberg. The physical symptoms you see is right on the top. Everything else is underneath, the water, which you don't see. Whereas you need clinical medical expertise to deal with the top bit, the physical bit, the community can have the expertise to deal with a whole lot of other things that does not require a medical person to deal with. Now, you can imagine hospitals in Britain have people, don't they, where they are not because they have physical problems. Their physical problems are under control, but they are stuck in the hospital because of one of the other three elements. So that's the way it works in Kerala, and that is how a successful community model can empty some beds in NHS hospitals, I think.
And also just to add to that, I'm not sure what the laws are in the UK, but in many countries around the world, only doctors and sometimes only oncologists can prescribe morphine. and controlled medications for pain relief. But there's a model in Uganda to train nurses to prescribe, which has been very effective because the number of nurses in the country are so many more than the numbers of doctors in the country. And in terms of your question of lay people administering, I think that does happen when people are prescribed morphine tablets and they can take them home and then their relatives can administer them. Robin? Oh, sorry, I just wanted to say that the access to pain medication is a huge, huge problem. There's actually 75% of the global population does not have access to controlled medication for pain relief. So when you're trying to provide palliative care and you can't even address the pain, it's a huge issue and it's something that needs to be addressed as a priority, I think, in the world. So, Professor? Yeah, absolutely.
Exactly.
That's
very
yeah.
They take the whole thing into the picture, the personal circumstance, the whole family's involved.
Mm.
And that's what matters.
Yeah, absolutely.
Exactly. And that's what the world's like.
Yeah, thank you very much. Robin, you had a question? Sure, and then we'll take one more question and then we'll have to close, unfortunately.
I'm just responding to the. I'm just responding to the gentleman at the front because I think he highlights quite a helpful and important point, and it does tie in with what we've heard about Kerala. In New Zealand, when I went there in 1987, there was a major asthma epidemic. We had five times the death rate for any other part of the world, and that was partly managed by introducing the whole idea of self-management, because the gap between the onset of asthma and getting medical help was often too long to prevent deaths occurring. Now, if you think also in the area of heart attacks and sudden death from heart attacks, there are lots of training for lay individuals to do life support and so on and so forth. There's no reason why the same facility couldn't be given in a team concept to a family. And there's a hesitancy here for all the variety of reasons which have been highlighted by our speaker as to why families should be empowered to be administering drugs at the end of life. And it'd be, I feel quite radical about this, so you've touched on an issue, because I took a family aside just the other day and I taught them how to use diuretics and how to use morphine with somebody who had terminal cardiac failure, and said, now you manage the breathlessness, because if they wait, all they get is NHS-24 and an ambulance, and that's the wrong approach. So I actually think there's a lot of scope to have, when we call it the team is not professionalized team, the team includes the immediate support persons who are the next of kin, and involve them in very simple, very sort of defined medical decision-making on their family members' behalf, so that they can take initiatives and not feel helpless. We could do a lot in that territory, and I agree with what you've just highlighted.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think you're right, but
this one. I'm sorry, we have one question over here.
It's not really a question, more just want to say that here in Orkney we've got a really good palliative care unit, McMillan unit, and we're very, very proud of what we do in that unit. But when we can, we try to get people home to die. And there's where, you know, our specialist care comes in, is because we can give them the support to die at home. And yeah, I think the community nurses here are brilliant. They give us all the backup that we need as well, so they can go in and give pain relief. Of course, pain relief is specialist, and I think that handing it over to the families, we've had problems at times where people have been rather overdosed. So it has to be a pretty careful monitoring of this.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a... It's a very delicate balance when obviously dealing with controlled medications, because they've controlled for a reason. And although there is a big shortage in a lot of the world, there's also been major problems, especially in the United States, with misuse of these medications. So, yeah, it's very important to use common sense and to really be very careful. We've unfortunately run out of time for the session, so it just remains to say thank you very much to everyone for coming to join us and for listening to us. And thank you very much to the presenters. Thank you.